and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
How you doing?
All right, call the roll. Mr. Gertz?
Yes.
Mrs. Vettori?
Yes.
And Mr. Barker?
Yes.
Real quick, before we jump into the first agenda item, this can be and should be part of the official meeting minutes, it is someone's birthday today. Mr. Gertz, happy birthday.
Actually, and before we do the approval of the agenda and addendum, I received several emails, and so I would like to clarify. I know that there were several thoughts and concerns about the moving of this meeting. Unfortunately, last week I had a very close family member turn for the worse and pass away. So I apologize, but I hope you understand why today's meeting was moved. And I appreciate your presence today.
All right, first item on the agenda is to approve the agenda or any addendum items.
So moved.
All right, do I have a second?
I second.
Any discussion? All right, the agenda stands. Next item is to approve or amend the meeting minutes from the... Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you. I told you I was... Bear with me, folks. Let's vote. Mr. Gertz?
Yes.
Mrs. Vettori?
Yes.
And Mr. Barker?
Yes.
Next item, thank you, Jackie, is to approve or amend the meeting minutes from our last meeting, February 9th, 2016.
So moved.
A second.
I second.
Any discussion? The meeting minutes? There are none. Go ahead and call the vote. Mr. Gertz?
Yes.
Mrs. Vettori?
Yes.
And Mr. Barker?
Yes.
All right, thank you. Next agenda item is open to the public.
Yes, thank you. We just want to reiterate, please keep all topics to today's agenda item, please, and 3-minute limitation.
You never been to law school, right? That's why.
Good morning, everyone, and good morning to those of you who are watching us on YouTube. I came up today to congratulate and thank the Park District for an activity that they're going to be engaged in the future. That's upcoming in September. They're going to bring in a group called the Wall That Heals. The Wall That Heals is a half-size replica of the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. So I want to say thank you for that. It was 1967, May. I was graduating from high school, and my friend Danny was also graduating along with me. I was headed off to college, and Danny chose to go into the Army. Danny went off, did basic. I went off and did a summer job. Danny came back. Kind of an unhappy guy, and told me that he didn't like the basic training. I said, what's the problem? He said, well, it wasn't the rigor. That wasn't the problem. He just didn't like being trained to be a warrior. I said, Danny, that's what the military's about. He said, no, not for me. I signed up for the medical corps. I'm going to be a medic. He went back, and he trained. In about 10 or 11 months, he came home on leave, and he said, I've done it, I'm a medic. But Danny was a whole different guy than when he left. He was much, much older. He was 19 years old, going on 35, I guess. Much, much older, serious man at that point. At the end of his leave, he came over to me, and he said, Dave, you've been a good friend. He put out his hand, shook my hand. You've been a good friend to me. I want to thank you. I want to thank you for being my friend. I probably won't see you again. I said, what? You're crazy. He answered, they'll keep you for a year. They'll let you home on leave. I said, I don't think so. Danny went off to the medical corps. He was sent to Vietnam almost immediately. He served for 6 months in Vietnam. He was killed in action. And that's been 48 years now. That's what I'm telling you. But when that wall comes in September, I hope to be able to go over to the wall, reach up, find Danny's name and touch it. And think about it. And then, in that late summertime, I want to be able to walk in the peace, the calm, the quiet, the natural world, and the natural environment here of the park. To walk in those paths and think about Danny. Think about the divergence of our lives. You know, I want to say thank you, Michelle Pinnell, for your part in bringing Dan and bringing the wall here. Thank you for helping me think about Danny. Thank you, Michelle. And if Danny were here, I'd say he'd be saying thank you, Michelle, as well. Thank you all.
I know how you feel.
Thank you, Dave. A lot of us came up during that era and lost friends there and other places. good morning. I'm interested. I've never heard the rule about addressing only topics on the agenda, and based on that agenda, that's something of a joke. I'm looking forward to hearing Mr. Royce's stirring recount of how snowmobiling was a great success at Observatory Park, a recounting of how the park has been open to more visitors with no ill effects, and how this needs to be expanded and extended next year. That is, if Mr. Royce and his new role as park czar deems it necessary to explain anything he does, because this board, contrary to good management and fiduciary responsibilities, has abdicated its power to Judge Vandella's puppet. Let me tell you what I observed the last Sunday of snowmobiling. One, no snowmobiles were there in the afternoon. I think ultimately less than 20 permits were issued. Two, visitors leaving the program at the observatory were turned away from the trails by signs prohibiting anyone other than snowmobiles. Three, no rangers were present to enforce the permits or routes. Of course, there was no need to because there were no participants, legal or otherwise. Four, snowshoeing the path the following day, we found low areas of the trail torn up or ice covered or both, making walking difficult for people that week. Five, the ice made by the machines was so bad that in spots that even they had left the path. Six, likewise, hikers had to bypass these areas, also going off the path. There were several snowmobile paths running alongside the trees in the open field from the road to the designated trail, in clear violation of the park directives. In essence, for a limited benefit of very few people who have a 90-mile option open to them, the trail was shut down for all practical purposes for the rest of the community of users for several days. There was significant trail damage. Any nesting animals, hawks and owls are pairing up, egg laying and incubating now. Squirrels and other animals are starting to pair up, etc. were disturbed by the noise and the fumes. This is not a good use of our resources. How many people were closed from using the park because of the experiment for less than 20 permit holders? No one can say for sure. But a couple of days later, my wife and I walked the nearby Headwaters Trail where there's an eagle nest that has been regularly active. I mention that specifically because disturbing nesting eagles is a crime and Mr. Oros has been known to violate game laws and EPA restrictions. This was a walk in mid-afternoon in the middle of the week. We encountered small groups walking for pleasure and exercise, people watching the nest for activity, people enjoying being alone and quiet, people with small children trying to work out some of their pent-up energy, people walking their dogs, etc. We saw more people on that non-weekend day enjoying a park trail undamaged by machines, looking for wildlife, not harassed by noise, than the number of permits issued by Mr. Horace's experience. Why are people being closed out of their parks with the pleasure of a few who bring with them and leave behind only disturbance. Mr. Barker, you have a community reputation as an honest businessman, a man committed to the youth of this community, a ball player with an achievement few dared to dream of. Yet you have let yourself be tied to an unpopular board, given away your rights to actually oversee what goes on, let your reputation become a part of Mr. Morris's history of illegal hunting, questionable trapping, and EPA violations. Why would you do that? Mr. Gertz, you have a long history of service to this community. You have exercised your independence several times on the board, declined to approve a $100,000 playground, voting repeatedly against snowmobile. Yet with the bylaw changes, Mr. Morris can take a budget, you approved one last meeting for $200,000, move funds around in it, and could theoretically issue two contracts for $49,999 each to accomplish the same goal without your approval. He certainly ignored you, and it's a slap in the face, and you and prior boards to bring his experimental snowmobile. Why do you tolerate this? Ms. DeToro, frankly, you come to this board with a poor reputation from West Yaga. Without getting into specifics, which only results in recriminations back and forth, let me say simply that I do not expect much from you, but I had hopes that I'm wrong. This board needs to realize, since you have, in essence, put the fox in charge of the hen house, this board needs to realize Mr. Orris, who recently terminated a person with extensive financial knowledge and experience with the parks, so he has pretty much unfettered authority over park money, works for you. You can terminate it or demote him. He does what he does is a reflection on you and your reputation. I suggest you do the right thing, either reining in or firing. Thank you. Let me give this to be entered into the record.
Anyone else?
My name is John Augustine. I'm a Parkman Township resident. You know, I'd also like to mention something about the snowmobiling. I heard just this recently that NOAA, the National Organization for Atmospheric Studies at the national government, declared that last January was the warmest January ever recorded, ever. And they've been keeping records way back, I think, to the 1800s. That's National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. So it seems like to celebrate that, the park declared that they would start a snowmobiling program in January, something that would put more carbon dioxide into the air and if anything, encourage people to burn gasoline and fossil fuels to make things worse. So congratulations, Park. It was mentioned at the January Park Commissioners meeting that there were no incidents regarding snowmobiling. Yet every weekend that we were up there in January and February, we found people from Protect Your Parks found tracks from snowmobiling that had apparently gone into illegal areas. There were tracks going off through the middle of the field. There were tracks going out of the road right away on park property. I have videos of those, so if you'd like to see those, I'd be glad to show those videos to you. Another issue that came up last month, there was a suggestion about putting white antlers back into some of the park ponds as a control measure for plant too vigorous plant growth in park ponds, etc. And they may work fine in a park pond. A park district is different. The priority should be protecting the species in the park, biodiversity. And I'd like to mention that I would have liked to have brought it up at that meeting when it was brought up, but I was not allowed to. But white amur were introduced in park property years ago. I recall because I remember my neighbor has a pond, and she was having problems with algae growth. So I asked the park about that at the time. And at that time, they were just trying to get rid of the fish. And I think John Oros might recall that he had something to do with, I seem to recall, John, weren't you trying to get the fish out of there? They were an unmitigated disaster at the time. They turned the park pond that they were introduced. I think they introduced five of them, as I recall. That's what I checked my, I have a file on that. I checked my file, and that's what I had written down. So they were they're an introduced species. Supposedly they're triploid, genetically, they're not supposed to reproduce, but I talked to one of the biologists at the Cleveland Museum, and he said there's no guarantee that fertile ones might slip through, which could cause more problems. I talked to somebody where they had been introduced in one of the state parks, and he said they were a complete disaster there. So this was an example at the meeting. There was nobody present that had any that was able to bring up any history of white amors in the park from the past. There were comments made.
I can help you there, Doug.
Yeah,
because the state of Ohio is the biggest customer that used white amors. And if you don't believe me, go down to Lake Aquila, and I brought a boat launch. There's a sign that says, if you catch a white amor, put them right back. I've used them for 25 years. They're great. They do not reproduce. They have to have swift moving water, for one thing, to lay their eggs, if they lay any. To make a tripod, all you have to do is hold their eggs at 102 degrees for about 30 seconds, and then they're sterile. I have never had a problem with them. I think they're great. When I first introduced them into my lake, you could have walked across the top on the weeds. I bought three. My lake's about an acre. By the end of the year, the water was clear as a bell, and I quit chemicals from that point on.
Well, I can just say that the park pond that they introduced, everything else disappeared. They turned it into a model. This is according to the park people that I talked with. And they wanted to get them out of there.
I just had a chance to talk to Paul Perra before the meeting and encourage him to go ahead and get some more.
And what did Paul say?
Fine.
And Paul may have not have been around when that, I don't recall who the park biologist was at that time.
It was back in the 90s.
You were all John. You were chasing the fish out of there, weren't you? Weren't you trying to get rid of them?
I think that we're just about at our past our 3 minutes, if you could.
Okay. The only other thing I was going to mention is maple sugaring in the park. Do you have a park? Is there a park plan for maple sugaring? You know, can anybody tell me why they do it? Is it just as a demonstration? Is it as a money-making deal for park income? Does anybody know? Is there any, we tried to get information as to what, if there is a park plan, as to what the goals of it are, and we haven't received anything. Can anybody tell me?
Well, you like to use the park, don't you? We'd like to have that as a demonstration.
Well, I'm just trying to find out what the purpose of
the SAPs are writing. I mean, it's great.
Some of the information that we had through public information requests were that other areas, a number of other parks were investigated for, can we do maple sugaring in these other areas? And I'm just wondering why what's the idea of expanding it into other areas of the park?
I mean, but this public time is not used for Q&A, so you're more than welcome to send us emails or call the offices.
In the past, oftentimes when I have sent in emails, I haven't gotten a response I like to do it here because it's on, this way it's on the public record, and I don't expect that you have an answer to everything, but you could say, hey, I'll get back with you.
Okay.
You know, that would be fine.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kathy Hannity from Sheridan Township. Happy birthday, Mr. Cruz. I too am kind of dismayed to hear the new restrictions imposed upon the public comment at our meetings. This is really the only opportunity that the public has to publicly address the board. So it would be nice if we had, thank you for giving us a little leeway at this point, but I'd like to make that a permanent feature. I do have a question, and this is not something I expect you to answer today, but I would like the question to be on the record, so that's why I want to say it here today. Of the board members, when you stand back and look objectively at the amount of control that you've given to the current executive director, how do you see that benefiting the people of Geauga County? And also, I wonder, will Michelle Pinnell's position be filled at the same level of authority? And if so, will a job search be implemented soon? So those are both questions that I would like to have on the record, and I, you know, you don't have to answer them today, but thank you.
Thank you. I thought you were calling people in order of height. I'm Barb Hardington from Munson Township. My question is directly related to the board agenda. So while the agenda is lengthier in the amount of space, there are less items on it. I have appreciated, John, that you have always given me the packet that I've requested ahead, and I was disappointed to see, and I hope it is not a new trend, that there's no report of the different departments. The previous, for people who don't know in the audience, the previous packets have included a report of each department, which I have personally found very interesting to know, you know, what people are doing in it. You know, I don't need to know the number of hours people do things, but just to know those activities. I'm hoping that I would like to see that back into the board packet so the board knows what the departments are doing. I found that very interesting. And if not, maybe it could be available to the public in the park offices, because I think that's was an important feature.
We are actually doing those weekly. So they're not part of the packet. We're getting weekly updates from every department.
So if, then I think maybe, John, maybe we need to have a discussion of having that then also included in the packet to know, because we would like as a public to know reports from the parks, or to make that available to everybody weekly. Could even be on the website, whatever. So this is a comment I saw that missing and was disappointed that we would no longer be privy to that information.
Thank you.
Do we have time for one more? Is there anybody else?
Thank you, everyone. Next up is the presentation of the financial statement for the month of February. We'll present that. The beginning fund balance for the general fund on February 1st, 2016 was $5,921,075.74. Expenditures were $2,429,635.16. Revenue of $20,758.28, with an ending fund balance for the general fund of $3,512,198.86. For the land improvement fund, started the month of February with $2,877,894.91. Expenditures of $11,209.24. Revenue, because of our transfer from the general fund for land improvements, land acquisition, we saw $2,176,88. Sorry about that. With the ending fund balance for land improvement of $4,867,862.55. The retirement reserve account started with $57,521.39. Revenue with that big interest of $16.34, with ending fund balance of $57,537.73. Any questions on the February financial statement? Okay. Request a motion to approve.
Also move.
I second.
Right. Any discussion? None. Go ahead and call the vote. Mr. Gertz?
Yes.
Mrs. DeTore?
Yes.
And Mr. Bart?
Yes.
Thank you. Next up are the vouchers for the month of February. Request a motion to approve the vouchers for the month of February.
Also move.
I second.
All right, any discussion, any questions about the vouchers?
I have a question, actually. I don't think that we required a vote for just the presentation. I think it was the vouchers is what we, correct?
That's correct, that is correct.
So we voted on it, we didn't need to, so now we are voting on vouchers.
Yes, thank you. I could get used to this, sit right here. So, thank you. Any discussion on the vouchers, any questions? All right, we'll call the vote. Mr. Gertz?
Yes.
Mrs. Vettori?
Yes.
And Mr. Brock?
Yes.
Thank you.
Corey did the voucher, you got some new glasses.
Did. And the lenses get thicker every year. All right, next up, under new business, is surplus property. Any questions on surplus property?
So moved.
Okay. Jackie, can I get a second?
Second.
All right. Any questions, any discussion about the surplus property?
What did you trade those two Fords in for? Newer models, is that what it was?
We go Ford this time, man?
Yeah, they were some new ones.
Newer Fords. Any other questions, any discussion? Good vote. Declaring these items surplus property. Mr. Gertz?
Yes.
Mrs. Vettori?
Yes.
And Mr. Bart?
Yes.
Thank you. All right, next up is an update from planning and operations on four construction projects.
So I have to go over, we have four items and they relate to projects. The first one is the Nassau Station Observatory project. On March 1st, we had a public opening for the construction of that project. We received three lump sum bids ranging from $1,199,500 to $1,208,475. The submitted bids were all within the budget amount of $1.4 million for the project. The recommendation is to award the project for a bid of $1,199,500 to Hummel Construction for the renovations to the observatory. Hummel's bid was complete. After findings for recovery, there were no issues financially with the company, and they've also performed the construction of Observatory 1, Phase 1, and multiple other projects in the past, and we've had no issues with that.
I have a statement rather than a question. I don't know what the procedure is normally for bids. I would always personally like to see those. We did not get them.
Okay, I know the bid opening because of when it was, and working through the process, Cheryl and John, I think, have all the bid results. I have memos for each one, so
right.
I'm not aware.
Yeah,
okay.
To see each one of what their statements were and what they include, et cetera.
Yeah, there's a bid tabulation with each one. Also, there's a recommendation from the consultants involved with the project, and like I said, all the findings and recovery for everything we do.
Yeah, I mean, I know there's a process. I just like to see what, you know, they submit.
So that was for Nassau. I'll go over all four items, and then if you want to make one motion or if you want to have questions about each one specifically. The second bid opening was for the Rookery Asphalt Project. This was some asphalt trail resurfacing out of the Rookery and also some meadow establishment we're doing. For that project, we received six bids ranging from $67,872 on up to $97,945.12. Again, the recommendation for this contract would be to award to Green Valley Paving, who submitted the low bid of $67,872. It's within the budget, it's $70,000 for the project.